Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
Good evening.
On behalf of the East Chicago Public Library, myself, Charles Moore, the Chicago Board of Trustees and staff, we would like to welcome you to the rededication of the William Bill Passmore Career Services Center. I would like to recognize our mayor, the Honorable Anthony Copeland. If you'd like to come up and say howdy doody, you're more than welcome.
And I would like to kisses.
Now we would like to recognize all the clergy in the building. If you'd like to stand up, please. Thank you so much for being here. And if there's any other dignitaries in the library, please stand so we will be able to acknowledge you, because you do so much great work for the city of East Chicago and Lake County, Northwest Indiana. I would also like to recognize any of our board of trustee members, specifically Ms. Toni Smith. And thank you for taking time out, you know, of your busy schedule to be here with us. And we greatly appreciate that. The staff of the Chicago Public Library's Public Relations Department, they have worked long and hard to put this together to make sure that it is a success. And it is something that we will remember, because Mr. Passmore is an individual that must be remembered. Amen. Also, I would like to acknowledge the friends of the East Chicago Public Library. We're trying to get them reestablished here because over the years, the friends have been supportive of all our programs. In other words, they're the ones that help bankroll programs like this, our summer reading program, our cultural program, and we're in the process of having a registration drive for any of you all that would like to become a friend, and I say friend, of the East Chicago Public Library. You can see Ms. Christine Russell, because she is one of the individuals that are spearheading this, and she has been working long and hard to get the friends back here at the library. I'm not going to take up much of your time, because when I first came here in 1982 from Memphis, Mr. Passmore was on the library board. And he was one of these people that, I hate to say it now, but you saw him as a board member, and you saw him as a very good person. But the reason we're here is because the man is more than just that, because the Bible says you do not acknowledge the prophet within your own home, within your own community or city.
Amen.
Mr. Passmore, he was very instrumental in helping to get the Americans with Disabilities Act passed. Yes. We don't acknowledge that. But at the same time, if you think about it, you wouldn't have these little handicapped lanes in front of public facilities and supermarkets. You would not have handicapped accessible bathrooms. You would not have handicapped ramps. You would not have all of these amenities to our friends and our family that makes it so much easier for them to live healthy and productive lives. One thing that is going to Mr. Passmore's biography, he's basically said that there's enough cake for everybody, right, but you just have to get up and go get it.
Right.
And too often, those of us that have all of our health and strength, we sit back and do nothing because we're waiting for the next person to do something. We need more Bill Passmores in our lives. Because if we did, it would be a better world. So I'm going to, the only thing I can say is, we need to acknowledge such a great man. We need to remember him, and we need to tell our young people, get up and be about something.
Right. That's right.
And it's also ironic, On this day, Martin Luther King was assassinated. One person can make a difference. Right. And East Chicago had that person. He did make a difference. And because of Mr. Passmore, the world is so, so much better.
Right.
At this time, I'm going to ask, I hate to say it, but somebody's going to have my program, but Reverend Carl Lugwith to come up and give the, excuse me, invocation.
Amen.
Amen. Can't tell the players without a program. Let's bow our heads. Lord, our Heavenly Father, here it is Thursday, and we're gathering and asking for your presence.
Yes.
We were just reminded that someone very important in this country has been with you for 45 years today, taken away from us. We give thanks for his life, for his gifts, for his service. We know that he's part of that cloud of witnesses that even now is watching us as we gather in this library.
Yes.
This evening we ask your presence as we gather for a few moments to remember someone very important to us personally. We give thanks for Bill Passmore, for his work, for his love, for his caring for so many people. We're also assured that he too is in your presence, and he too is part of that cloud of witnesses that's watching and wondering, will our words become action after we leave this building? We pray your presence, as we ask that your Holy Spirit be amongst us, touch us and remind us of why we're called, why we're here, and what we're promising to do this evening. We ask these things in the name of Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
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 Next on the program, we will have the Pledge of Allegiance by Brownie Troop number 196 out of Chesterton, Indiana. And after they finish, we will follow the program as printed. Thank you.
May you all stand while we say the Pledge of Allegiance.
Give these young ladies a hand.
Yes. Let me just give Teresa another hand of applause for getting this from Bible Church. With her praise dance, you are invited to come in, speaking of the Holy Spirit, that is. Next, we will have remarks from Pastor Bobby Hawkins from Community Fellowship Outreach Ministries, following Mr. Michael Monaghan, Elder, Family Christian Center, Reverend Carl Ludwig, Dr. Edward Williams, former Library Board Trustee, and Mr. Marcus Martin, former Director of the Boys and Girls Club of Northwest Indiana. Pastor Hall.
Thank you. I greet you this evening in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. And I'm so honored to be here tonight to stand before you to give a few remarks in remembrance of my dear friend, my colleague, the late William Bill Passmore, who will forever live in my heart. He was indeed a legend, a pioneer, who initiated opening up many doors for many people. I had the opportunity to work with him. In fact, when I moved to Indiana from the south to north, coming up north, looking for work, I was told to go see Bill Passmore if you need a job. This great celebrity that everybody knew. He was famous, you know, because his name was known throughout the south. If you want a job, go to Indiana, East Chicago, Indiana in particularly. And there's a man named Bill Passmore and he will get you a job. So I did. I came to East Chicago and I went to see Mr. Bill Passmore. And I'll never forget the day that I went to his office. He said, wow, you one of them Davis girls. I said, yes, I am. He said, well, you know what? I got just a job for you. I'm going to place you at St. Catherine Hospital. This is one of my better sites. And we send good people out there. And he said, I don't really need to know too much about you because I know that you're a Davis and I know you know how to work. And I said, yes, sir. He said, I'll put you there for the summer. So he placed me at St. Catherine Hospital for the summer. And after the summer program has ended, he came back to St. Catherine and he said, well, I'm gonna place you in the office to work with me. I need some people there that can help me with the payroll to get the timesheets so he can have more time to spend in the field. So he placed me there at St. Catherine, and from that placement, we worked side by side for over 20 years. So I really got to know Bill Passmore. I really got to know this great, strong, fearless, mighty man of valor. He was indeed a man of substance.
Yes.
And what was so unique about Bill was that it was his popularity and his capabilities to help so many people. He had a heart to serve. I witnessed his work ethics. Bill came to work, come rain or shine, sleep or snow. Even when they told us we didn't have to go to work, he was at work. Mary Beth was picking him up, taking him to work. So he would go to work and he would report in every morning an hour or two early. He said, well, I need to get to work early so that I could study and read my words and pray. He said, called devil, when the devils come in, I want to have the office atmosphere set, okay? So he did exactly that. He would pray so that when we got to work, everything would be okay. And when he got to work, though, he was my alarm clock. He would call me every morning to make sure I was up and getting ready for work because he didn't want me to be late. He would call me every morning when he didn't have an exchange club meeting. And the morning that he had the exchange club meeting, that was the morning that I kind of was late coming in for work. But he was an awesome job developer. Do you not know that he was placing people in jobs Even before there was agency established to do just that, Bill Passmore was out there placing people on jobs. He was very instrumental in getting thousands of jobs for people all over this region. And if you went to him for a job, you were surely to get that job. Not only did he place people in jobs, but Bill had connection with the grocery stores. You know about that, the grocery stores. There were, people would come to him because they was hungry. He would send them to Ultras and some of the other grocery stores where he had this great connection to make sure that people had food to eat. Yes. He had connection with the clothing stores. When people come to him for a job, he wanted to make sure that they were presented well when they went for a job interview. So he would send them to various clothing stores. And I'll never forget the shoe stores. There was a shoe store that was going out of business or relocating somewhere. And they gave Bill all of those shoes from a baby size to adult size. We had so many shoes in the office that we did not know what to do with them, okay? I can recall Mr. William calling down to the office telling us that James Porter would be coming down the next day. So we had shoes all over the office. So what we had to do, we had to get rid of those shoes, you know, waiting for James Porter's visit. So we took the shoes next door to the Washerette on Main Street. Y'all remember the Washerette on Main Street? So we took the shoes over there, and the people that came in for shoes, we were able to sell them next door to get their shoes so that they would have some shoes to wear. I mean, that's just a few of the things that he did. I remember people coming to him, their light and gas is being shut off. And I recall him picking up the phone, calling NIPSCO, so that the people, well, light and gas would still stay on. Not only did he do that, I remember people needed rent and a place to stay. I remember him calling Carl Love, which had emergency referrals, and can you help this person? And he was able to help them. He was an awesome man. I love going to lunch with him. I went to lunch with him many times, and we would always go to Phil Smith or some of the upscale restaurants. He never took me to a little rinky-dink restaurant. He always took us to the best place. And he used to tell me, don't worry about the price. He said, oh, Bill got this, okay? But then on the other hand, he'll say, my name is Crime and Crime does not pay. So he never had to pay for anything because he knew everybody and everybody loved him. I had the opportunity, Mr. William and Mr. Porter allowed us to go to Washington, D.C. and Baltimore, Maryland. I had the opportunity to go out with him one night. You know, we went out to a party, a club somewhere. It was a $500 ticket to get in. And I was worried about how we was gonna get there, get in. He said, you with me, you with Bill. And again, he said, my name is Crime and Crime does not pay. So we were able to get into this nice, elegant banquet, $500 ticket. We were able to get into that, and we had an awesome time. Not only did we work together, but we attended the same church. Bill and I were members of St. Mark Amuzon Church, and Bill did a lot for St. Mark.
Yes.
I mean, he was awesome, kind-hearted, did everything he could for that church. He was the superintendent of Sunday school at St. Mark. And he also was a Sunday school teacher. He was the one that reviewed the lesson with everybody, making sure that we understood. Bill knew the word and he lived the word. He was very passionate and he had a very strong connection and love for his family. He loved his family, his sisters, brother, his nieces and nephew. He really loved his family. And Bill was willing to get out of his home and his church to hear, to see, and to touch the lost. At many times as I was going to church, morning worship services, I would see Mary Beth coming in to pick up Bill, to take Bill to the hospital to visit the sick. His ministry was definitely beyond the four walls.
Amen.
His life legacy in helping others inspired me to have an outreach ministry. He went to the highways, to the byways, to the correctional facility, to the nursing home. He embraced his God-given ministry as an ambassador for Christ. Yes. Everywhere he went. I'll never forget when I had a crisis. I really had a crisis. I had a sick daughter who at 8 months had open heart surgery at Michael Reese Hospital in Chicago, and she suffered brain damage from that. And one sickness to another sickness. But anyway, at the age of 8 months, can you imagine someone that's 8 months years old and their life benefit over $1 million in hospital? She had exhausted all of that. And she was canceled out of her insurance at the hospital. Can you imagine that? Well, I didn't know what to do. And the only way we could get her out of the hospital, we had to sign her out. So I called Mr. Passmore. I said, Bill, I don't know what to do. He said, you called the right person. When I called him, he said, don't worry about it. We'll get her another hospital. So he was able to hook us up with the Shriners Hospital in North Chicago. And to make things even better, he would send the people over to pick us up to take us to Chicago. And I just thank God for Bill Passmore. He enjoyed his life, he loved his pretty ladies, and he was content in whatever situation he was in. And I never really heard Bill complain about anything. He never did complain. His zeal to serve others is evident in the results that he accomplished in helping so many people. He made an awesome contribution to East Chicago, to Lake County, and to this region. So I want to say thank you, Cheryl, for inviting me. Thank this establishment for remembering, for having this rededication of the Career Service Center in honor of my dear friend, William Bill Passmore. Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening.
What a wonderful day to have a ceremony for a great man.
Amen.
I want to thank Cheryl and the board of directors and Mr. Charles Moore. I want to thank you all for inviting me to be a part of this ceremony. I love Mr. Passmore, you know, like a father would love a son. And during my times of crises, Mr. Passmore did help me out also. The Bible says in Romans 15:1-6, it talks about a strong and enlightened one who must tolerate and bear with weaker and less enlightened brethren until they too become strong in faith and knowledge and learn to live in unity. And when I read that particular scripture, God revealed to me that that was the character of Mr. Passmore, and that's what he displayed during his life here on earth. As I said, I love Mr. Passmore like a son would love a father. And you know, Mr. Passmore proved to me again and again that there were several pieces to achievement. He says, Michael Monaghan, he says, set goals for yourself. He said to have a single-minded determination to make each day count. Everybody say, make each day count. He also said, have a strong belief in hope and a vision of a better tomorrow. Mr. Passmore would often tell me that adversity would teach me valuable lessons. And he was right, because I have had my share of it. Has taught me to focus on things that are truly important in life, like the love of God and the love of my family. Mr. Bill Passmore would also say, Michael Monaghan, when you are given a second chance in life, he said, don't take it for granted. He said, as a result of that, I have learned to forgive for good, because it has proven to me that it is a prescription for health and happiness. I want to share with you some instructions that God gave me about 2 years ago when I had a setback in my health. God instructed me to write my story. It's titled Brainstorm, A Story of Faith Through Brain Injury. And in this particular chapter, I write about some advice that Mr. Passmore gave me. Having said that, I just want to let you all know that 2014 in June, that book will be published. The chapter reads, starts out by saying, learning to let myself hope. And in this particular chapter, I talk about some advice that Mr. Passmore gave me. It had been 9 months since my stroke, and there's joy again and hope again. Although I'll never be completely free of the pain, but that's okay. Pain is a pathway to a closer and deeper relationship with God. I know now that nothing can come my way that God and I can't handle together. As Paul has said many times in this scripture, Philippians 4:13, he says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And you know, God continues to open doors for my wife and I to minister, to be a comfort to others. You know, every few weeks I hear of some other family that has been visited by tragedy. And when possible, I try to be there. And whenever I do, I think about the simple advice that Mr. Bill Passmore gave me many years ago. He says, Michael Monaghan, he says, be there for someone. I did not know at that time how prophetic his words would be. But God has engineered the circumstances of my life to give me a ministry of being there for others. I never could have been or would have been if I hadn't lived through my pain. And we know that God turns tragedy into triumph. You know, the pain I've encountered, you know, that year in my life, it changed my focus. I realized I needed God's help each day. And each day I prayed, Dear Father, help me to be there for others in the same way you were there for me. Now, you know, I fail occasionally, fragile as I am, but God is still there. You know, a few weeks ago, I was going through an old box in the garage, and I rediscovered an essay that I had written in college. And the assignment had been to write about the person who had been the greatest influence in my life. The person who I think had the most influence on my life was Mr. Bill Passmore. Mr. Bill Passmore said, Michael Monaghan, that's what he called me, Michael Monaghan. He used my full name. He was always there when I needed him. And whether it was for advice or just to listen to me, he taught me right from wrong. Although I didn't always listen, He always helped me through some rough times by encouraging and backing me up. Mr. Bill Passmore supported me through many activities, such as school and athletics and church involvement and all other activities. Mr. Bill Passmore made me respect myself as well as respect him. I would like to live my life as Mr. Bill Passmore lived his life, with all the love and the caring and the responsibility that he showed toward me and many others. But in closing, I'd just like to say that Mr. Bill Passmore was my friend, he was my mentor, but most of all, Mr. Bill Passmore was my hero. My time is up, and I'm going to take my seat. Thank you.
Actually, I have a long thing done, but I'm not going to read that. I just wanted to share some thoughts. Cheryl's been thanked. Mr. Moore's been thanked. Nobody's thanked Laura Passmore.
Amen.
That's very nice. And I'd like to express my greetings to Mary and Esther and little Bill. I'm so glad you all are together. I haven't gotten to see you since Bill passed away. And I met Bill many, many years ago. I was a little kid. Bill was always around town doing things. And he was important. You could tell he's important. And he was at every sporting event they had at Washington High School. I don't know if you remember this. He was always there. He was at scout outings. He was the president of the Junior Chamber of Commerce. Well, this is going to fall down this line. And then Exchange Club. It was Thursday morning meetings that Bobby spoke about. And that's where I really got to meet Bill. And you know, you meet somebody that you've been impressed with from afar, and discovered that this guy is really wonderful. Now, the Passmores might wonder who we're talking about, because it's been mentioned that no prophet is, you know, really respected in his own land. But you guys have heard this, and you should know a lot of this. Exchange Club, Bill was just a fantastic person. He was, for a very long time, the spirit of the East Chicago Exchange Club. When he passed away, the Exchange Club, in fact, changed. A couple years ago, instead of meeting at 6:45 in the morning, we were having supper meetings at places that served alcoholic beverages. Okay, that I don't have any use for that.
Okay.
But he got me involved in a lot of things. One of them was at St. Mark's. They used to have Brotherhood Week. This is a bonus to know Bill. Brotherhood Week, worship service, right? Sunday, yes. In February. Guess who Bill invited several times to sit with Dave Duerson, Ernie Banks, got to eat lunch with him too. That would have never happened. You know, I was a kid, I just watched Ernie Banks. He had influence, okay? He's pointed out, I don't have power, I have influence. And there's a big, big difference. He introduced me to people with disabilities. You know, it's easy if you don't have that problem in your life not to deal with them. And I ended up being chairman of the Exchange Club Ramp Building Committee, built 25 ramps for people during those times, had to raise the money. We actually ramped this library at one point before they redid the whole front. If you go outside and look on the wall on the right-hand side, there's a couple of holes. That's where we drilled the rails in, because there used to be steps coming out of here. We cut the concrete, Bill was here to help. Another fellow that was a double amputee, one Saturday, was just me and him. He's drilling and he can't, well, I don't want to stretch that out, but I was went with Bill to Indianapolis, influence. I drove him, he says, let's go see the governor. Okay, do you have an appointment? No, okay, no. We go in, wheel in, secretary sitting there. Hi, I want to see the governor. Oh, hi, Bill, just a minute. Click, don't, sure, go on in. And we're sitting there with people. He just walks in, and the governor welcomes him. It was just beautiful. Influence is important because partially of how you wield it. Bill taught me something about wisdom. Wisdom is actually nothing more than believing what you already know. Okay? All of us know we should wear seatbelts. Every week you hear about somebody that also knew that and they ended up under the car after they hit something. All of us know we should watch what we eat. If you really believed it, you would. Okay, all of us know we should exercise. I'm not the skinniest person here, so those of us who are Christians, we have known for most of our lives that Christ offers us freedom. And we have also known for most of our lives that Christ expects things from us. Right. Treating each other with love.
Right. Amen.
Always.
Always.
Now the day you get a little wisdom and you stop knowing it, but it becomes part of you, then that's when you change.
Yes.
Wisdom very often is something we already knew. One of the things that Bill emphasized is you should never be ugly with anybody. Never be rude to them, because as he said, you might have to cross that bridge again. And let me share how he impressed this on me very strongly. I worked at a social service agency, Bill, and I would communicate. I was across the street from the welfare department in Gary, down the street from the township. We worked a lot together, and we'd help people that had some problem. And to make a long story short, here's a lady comes over. They had messed her up. She lost her benefits because of the caseworker not doing what she was supposed to have done. But this lady lost her benefits, and I decided, you know, they really need to be sued because we had a good case. And I talked to Bill about it. He said, Carl, he says, let me tell you a story. He says, I get jobs for lots and lots of people. He says, there's a place over in Illinois. I only take white people there. No. He says, because it's a white community and they'll only hire white people. And if I were to take a black person there, they'd probably find a reason to refuse them, and they will never allow me back with another individual. He says, my job isn't to change their minds about race or society. My job is to get jobs for my people. And so as long as I don't, you know, they always hire my people. Said, I could probably sue them next time if they turn me down for a black person. He said, but then what would happen? I would have a place that would never, ever, ever again let me walk in the door. And they're not going to take my referrals for your job. He says, plus I get a job someplace else for somebody that has more jobs here. He says, if you sue the welfare department, you think they're ever going to talk to you again? I said, oh, good point. So the Salvation Army and I, for a couple months, kept this lady afloat until she got her benefits. Now, wisdom is when you get smart enough to make good decisions. I knew I shouldn't have done that. Who am I trying to impress? I'm a big shot. I get to sue the welfare department? Just kind of one last thing. You know, Bill started out, you know this best. He had lots of strikes against him. Grew up in a not wealthy family. Early on, had an accident, had to go to the state hospital.
ended up in a hospital room then in Indianapolis at 40, 50, 60 people, maybe two nurses, if you're lucky. Okay? They didn't pay attention to how they were treating him. He got gangrene. Dr. Grooms is the only person that would talk to him. Everybody else is scared to death of him. They sent him home to die. Dr. Grooms came to town and saved his life, Bill told me. Now, this is tremendous.
Yes.
Tremendous. And, you know, this guy had everything in the world against him. He's black, you know, well, it was still a white community. And it was. And when I came here, it was already mixed. When Bill was born, 9, 10 years, or when Bill had his accident 10 years before that, those of you that are old know that there used to be a swimming pool in Washington High School. Remember that? And they filled it in so the black kids wouldn't swim.
That's right.
That's the world that Bill grew up in, okay? And so he gets sent off, he comes back, he's got everything against him. He's a wheelchair, crippled, and then they take his legs off. And so easy to curl up and die. And what does he do? You know, he goes to college, degree, actually it's from St. Joe's, Calumet, right, up in Whiting. On the President's Commission was handicapped American of the Year back in 1968. President Nixon gave him the award. Can you imagine anybody more politically opposed to each other? He was on the board of National Easter Seals Foundation. The only person wasn't there because of being wealthy, a millionaire. He was there because of his stature nationally. You know, it was just absolutely fantastic. President's Committee on the Handicapped. I brought a poem. I shared it. Cheryl about it. You worked in his office. He had a poem on his wall. Do you remember this poem? I'm going to read it to you. I made some copies if you want. The World Is Mine. It's written by a guy named Red Foley, who's a country and western singer, by the way. Today, upon a bus, I saw a girl with golden hair. I envied her. She seemed so gay, and I wished I was as fair. When suddenly she rose to leave, I saw her hobbled down the aisle. She had one leg and wore a crutch, and as she passed, a smile. Oh God, forgive me when I whine, I have two legs, the world is mine. When you get this from Bill, it's hanging on his wall. First time I read it, just whose office it's in. It's a beautiful poem. It goes on. It's worth reading. If you're not familiar with it, I won't read the rest. You think you got problems? Guess what? You got nothing.
No.
You got nothing. Bobby mentioned going to the hospital. Bill went to the hospital every Sunday. Went to the prison every Sunday to visit. Christmas, New Year's Eve, Bill was in the hospital visiting the sick people. I'm working with people with disabilities. Bill is in the hospital. There's somebody gets disabled, boom, Bill is there. And he dedicated actually his life to finding work for people because he knew there is no respect if there is no work. And part of that was getting people to respect themselves first. All politics is local. Bill was nationally known, but this is really where he made the world of difference. And, you know, if you don't know who he is, find out. He loved people, and he knew the one thing everybody needed was having faith in themselves and having a job. This is a fitting recognition for the wonderful thing that he did. Thank you.
Carl, I'll add that he could also recite that poem. Yeah. He could, word for word. Yes. He would sit in his office, and he would, in moments of trouble, In agony, Bill could recite that poem line for line. To our Honorable Mayor, the Honorable Anthony Copeland, to our First Lady, Carolyn West Copeland, to Mr. Charles Moore, the Director of the Library, and to Ms. Cheryl Smith. Where is Reverend Smith? Cheryl, stand up. This is a young lady that exemplifies outreach, and Mr. Moore, you will attest to that. She carries outreach to the umpth degree. Cheryl, you do such a wonderful job for this city, for this library, for this Board of Trustees, and today we honor you as well for thinking of our friend, Bill Passmore, a person who stood by himself. Congratulations. Well, this is what you get when you are at the bottom of the program. Everyone has already said what needed to be said. Do I have stories? I have stories. I have stories that unfortunately you're not going to hear tonight. Because Bill Passmore, Al McLean, and myself, we swore, and those two are in the ground now, but their spirits live with me every day of my life. But those are stories that, unfortunately, we kind of cut our fingers and let the blood run together, man. And we agreed, we're going to let those stories go to the grave. And Bishop, don't I have stories? No mention of Bill Passmore would be complete without the mention of Laura Austin Passmore.
All right.
Bill certainly had challenges, Tony. Just the mere fact of how he had to live his life. But here was a mom, and thank God for moms. That's why he gave us moms. Here was a mom that saw to, that instilled within him a will to live and a will to do for other people. Bill was a statesman. Bill knew presidents, he knew governors, he knew senators, he knew congresspeople. She taught Bill how to get along with all races of people. Bill could speak Hungarian, Carl. He could speak perfectly. He could speak Polish. He could speak Spanish. He could speak Yugoslavian. Bill could speak every language that there was. People would come in and I'd see him and I'd look Hawkins and Bill would be over in the corner. And these are people that just came to our country. But everybody knew to see Mr. Passmore. Anything you needed, Bill Passmore could supply it for you. I'm who I am because of Bill Passmore. Bill Passmore opened doors for me, Mayor. Bill pointed me in directions that I have never could tell him thank you enough. I'm who I am because of a Bill Passmore, Michael, like you. Mrs. Passmore might have been this tall. At least I think she was about that tall. But that voice could move mountains. When Ms. Passmore spoke, everything got quiet. Do you remember how they would have affairs in the city, Mayor? And people are sitting around at tables, and here would come this little old lady waddling in like that and would stop and people out of respect. Because she earned that. A mother who instilled in a Bill Passmore, the guy that we all love. No mention of Bill Passmore would be complete without these sisters, Mary and Hester. Because that cooking was a job within itself. Bill couldn't wash. Bill couldn't iron. Bill couldn't dress himself. He did the very best he could, but somebody had to step in. They had to step in. But there were also the girls, Connie, Mary Beth, Cheryl, Myrna. Did I miss anybody?
Carol.
And Carol, forgive me, darling, but you see how it works? Bill Passmore couldn't get up to go where he needed to go without you, and you. But you saw to it, and you helped him, you loved him, you did for him. We can't forget about Norma. Mm-hmm. Uncle Norm. Yeah. See, this might be a dedication to Bill Passmore, but we have to remember the pillars that made him who he was. Little William, I remember you as a little kid, driving Uncle William and us around, stopping in those grocery stores, stopping to get clothes for people, stopping to get shoes. Bill Passmore had a life that was lived of legacy. And certainly, this is a very fitting tribute to the honor of such a quality and complete person. You see, Bill worked at that. He worked as hard as he could to be the statesman that he was, to be the individual that he was, to be the person that showed love like he did.
Right.
Bill Passmore, the likes of which, Mayor, we're never going to see again. There are many who will try and imitate that, but we'll never, ever see the person of the caliber of William Austin Passmore. I thank God that this family allowed him to spend a little time with this little old kid here that Bill used to say, you know, go home and do so-and-so, so-and-so, so-and-so. Okay, Bill, and I would do it because I respected him. And the most difficult thing for me was having Bishop worked alongside him and then had to become his boss. And you all know that mean old man, Mr. Porter, would send me to do stuff to Bill. And you talk about the most difficult thing that there was for me to do. But I never went in and did it the way Mr. Porter said do it. I always went out of love and respect. It's difficult when you work with and then you become the boss. But Bill respected me, and I loved the heck out of Bill Passmore. And let me say finally, St. Catherine's, that Bill, the hospital owes a debt of gratitude to Bill Passmore because he always visited that hospital to uplift the spirits of people who were without and people who were infirm, the likes of which we'll never, ever see again. So relish in this moment, family, because it's very special. All of you should feel proud of the gentleman, the statesman, and the person that we all love. Thank you.
Wow. Wow. Say he was last, shall be first. So don't mind being last. Not at all. Giving honor to God and to my and many of your Savior, Jesus Christ. Because we know we would not be here if it wasn't for God, for divine intervention. We would not be here. And not for this very special occasion. And giving honor to the board of directors, Cheryl Smith, our mayor and first lady, Passmore family, Myrna Hackett, who contacted me and gave me the invite to come here today and started my mind to going through the files, saying, wow, memories. And to Pastor Bobby, Elder Michael, Reverend Ludwig, Dr. Williams, who spoke elegant words of truth, of a person that's impacted my life in many ways. It's somewhat difficult as I think of the memories, so I said, let me start off with a story of a situation where hanging with Bill Passmore, you're going to get some life lessons. Now, all these lessons weren't necessarily verbal, but through action. So I spent many weekends with him, but he called me on a Monday and asked me to go, you know, take him somewhere. So I said, okay. And he said, you want to go to a Bears football game? Now, this is back when the Bears were winning. So you know I said yes. So we get to the Soldier Field, and we're going in Soldier Field. He said, this way, he directed me which way to go. And he just puts his badge up. And they said, hey, it's not that heavy, we keep right on rolling. I said, wow. Can I get a badge too? But anyway, so we go, and then, now, we don't go sit in the stadium, we go onto the field. And I'm like, wow, we down on, and then, wait a minute, not only are we on the field, we go to the player's bench.
And I'm sitting back like, wow, I'm this young guy. And I'm like, man, I'm sitting down, all these players walking around. And then Dick Buckus comes up. And he begins talking with Mr. Passmore. And I'm standing there. And I look up. And in this geometrical rectangle are all these photographers. It must have been 30 to 40 photographers. All had their cameras. And I'm in shock. And all these lights are going, the lights are flashing. And I'm like, I couldn't believe it. I said, oh my goodness. I said, I'm not even dressed properly, you know, for this occasion, you know, I'm very casual. And I learned something from that, to be prepared. So even now, I keep a suit in my vehicle, just in case. You never know. So you know, I learned some things, and that was incredible. And as I recall, one Saturday, we were at St. Catherine Hospital. Now, this is something I learned. They had two receptions. They're doing a dedication of the building, one of their facilities there. And so I learned they have two receptions, one for the dignitaries, the VIPs, and one for the public. And guess which one we were at? The VIP and the dignitary. So now I'm up in line at the buffet, and they're the Rileys. Remember the Rileys, First National Bank?
Yeah.
I'm up in there. We jockeying for a position over, you know, the meats and everything. I'm saying, wow, you know, unbelievable. Because he would take you places, and he didn't give me any instructions when we went there. He just put you into those situations to let you know not to put any limitations on your life.
Right.
So that was another lesson I learned in life. It's already been said, Dr. Williams talked about the diversity and the people, you know, you would meet and he would speak their language. And you would see the respect and the love from these people. You couldn't help but say, this is something not ordinary, this is something totally different. And you begin to look at those situations, and I can talk about many of the things I learned just from him. And life, not through the words necessarily, but through the actions and the family. Oh my goodness, this wonderful, awesome family that I became a part of. And I can only describe the family in one word. In fact, this whole occasion, all the stories I heard, I can define with one word: love. And I'm not talking about the love, the worldly kind of love where, yeah, I love you if I'm getting something from you or you. No, I'm talking about the divine, unconditional love that's demonstrated and I saw throughout the family. And as I see today, many of you have known, and some of it's like a reunion, many of you haven't seen, but just the love is the first thing that comes out. And you think about when God uses a person like that, and in your journey in life, you come in contact with that person. And Laura Passmore. Through Bill Passmore and the times I would spend with him on the weekends, go to pick him up, and talking with the mom. One day we're looking out the window. Despite her illness, she was looking at other people, concerned about other people. And she's looking out the window, and over on Kennedy Avenue there was that bar, that joint. And she says, you know, there's no, who, she said, who's out there talking to those people? Who's telling them about the love of Christ? Who's doing that? And you know, those words stuck in my mind. I told Myrna this one time. Those words stuck in my mind. And so, for the last 11 years, the streets have been my pulpit. But it's through those prophetic words that I didn't realize my mission, my journey in life. And I think about, would I be where I am now if I had not met Bill Passmore? Would I have had some of the successes I've had in life if I hadn't met him? Oh, maybe God would have used someone else. But God uses people.
Right. Yes.
and he used Bill Passmore at a time in my life when I was on a journey, early in a journey. Difficulties, I heard that word come up many times, difficulties, challenges. But we need something, we need that anchor.
Right.
Okay? And we know that anchor, many of us know the anchor is Jesus.
Yes.
But he works through people.
Right.
So through Bill Passmore, and I can't thank the family enough for allowing me to speak today at this great event to honor Bill Passmore and the family. And the family. I would call all their names. I don't want to miss anybody. And many of your names, but deep in my heart, I always feel I'm part of the family because they welcome me in.
Yeah.
And I'll continue my journey. I'll continue to do the work that I'm doing because of the people, the person, Bill Passmore, who I had an opportunity to connect with and learn life lessons that I'm still using today. Thank you.
I do believe that today also is Mr. Bill Passmore's birthday.
Yes.
We have his rededication on his birthday. In addition to his many activities fostering equality, Mr. Passmore was in his fifth term as an East Chicago Public Library Board Trustee and his second consecutive term as President of the Library Board of Trustees. Shortly after his death, the library named its new career center for Mr. Passmore to commemorate his work for literacy and vocational education for all young people. And today, we wish to rededicate the Career Service Room in his honor by hosting this ribbon cutting ceremony. After today, we will work tirelessly to continue his legacy by providing career training and workshops, materials and resources that are timely and effective for today and future generations. We have already begun a small step in that direction by acquiring the JAWS program placed in the William Passmore Career Service Center, which is a read-aloud program developed for computer users whose vision loss prevents them from seeing the screen content. It also has a unique set of tools for navigating and assessing web pages for the vision impaired and those who have lost vision. In the near future, the program will be available for the public's use. Again, we would like to thank all of our staff and everyone who participated, and those of you who came out to celebrate with us on this special occasion, all of those that accepted and gave remarks, we really truly thank you. Thank the mayor for coming out, and any clergy and any dignitaries that we might have missed, we truly thank you for attending this special occasion. At this time, we will have an appreciation of thanks by his eldest sister, Mrs. Hester Passmore Frith, after which we will go over to the Career Services Center for the ribbon cutting that Mrs. Hester Frith will do, and then we'll have the benediction by Reverend Carl Ludwig, after which we'll have refreshments and fellowship in the Templeton Gallery. I knew Mr. Passmore, but not, I was a little girl, so those are the gave remarks, not to the extent that you all knew him, but I did know Mr. Passmore and grew up around him and his entire family. What a wonderful family.
Way over across the sea, somewhere, I remember it was in Africa. She called me, telling you the building after you take it home. I said, what? Africa. Well, a lot of ways from home. You know, I don't know how my brother will get home. I said, if you stay home in the United States, then you need to be in Africa. But he was there. He made home. He made back home. And then he come, he says, I'm home. I'm home. Thank you, Jesus. And you stay home. I don't know. He told me what to do, Cheryl. I want to thank everybody who came to this evening. She read. All my cousins, my nephew, my nieces, my daughters, all my nieces. I'm just thankful for taking time out to come here to regular. Remember Uncle William, my brother, my baby brother. I miss him too because he really pushed it all to me. He pushed it all the time. I was still with the boss. I remember when you was a little boy.
I, you know, I'm a Christian, and I figured Jesus knew the scriptures, and if Jesus ever read anything, there's one thing he probably read, and that's Aaron's blessing. And so I'm sure if he read it, he probably used it too. And if it's good enough for Jesus, it's surely good enough for us. So let's bow our heads for a second. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee. Give thee peace now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Long walk, I guess.